Our goal is that the knowledge of the glory of the Lord shall cover this earth as the waters cover the sea. Amen. And so when our cameras span, you'll see people in the congregation. Some of them are going to come to see you. They're going to be carrying this gospel message as well. And we want to join with you so that together we can cover the earth just like the waters cover the sea. So thank you so much, all of you. And thank you so much for allowing me to speak directly to the camera, all of you. We love you and we bless you. And no matter what happened to you in your day-to-day, this is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. 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 So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we're grateful to you. We thank you for who you are and what you've done. You're the mighty God, everlasting Father. You're the Prince of Peace. You're amazing in every way, glorious as we sing in every way. We thank you so much. We thank you for these dedicated brothers and sisters who are here. Lord God, we are one people here. Yes, we're one people. We're the body of Christ. That is so amazing, so overwhelming to the thought processes. So we want to thank you for it, and we want to thank you for lifting up everyone here, lifting up them up through their day and causing them to do great and marvelous things. And I just thank you that you have special things for each one of them. I know it's hard to believe sometimes because we see ourselves as ordinary people. We are ordinary people, but now you have made us extraordinary by the indwelling Holy Spirit. We are now sons of God, having been born of your Spirit. Thank you very much. It is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Thank you, Sister Stephanie.
Let all agree, there's no power like the power of Jesus. Jesus, let faith arise. Let all agree, there's no power like the power of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, the world. just want you, just want you. I just want you, just want you. I just want you, just want you. Nobody else will do, Jesus. I just want you, just want you.
Praise, worthy of all praise. Thank you, Jesus. You are worthy, worthy. All honor and glory are yours. Worthy, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for you. Thank you that you made yourself known to us. We know who you are, the creator of the universe, the Son of God. That's no small thing. Thank you. And because we know you, we give you all the praise, honor, and glory, because we know that every good and perfect thing comes from you. We're here because of you. We're here for you. We worship you. And Jesus, I know that when you show up, everything changes. Things that have been going on for years change in a moment. Time bends to your will. Science bends to your will. Matter bends to your will. Nothing can stand against you. Nothing can stand in your presence. Show up, broken things are made whole. When you show up, lost are found. When you show up, sadness turns to joy. So, Father, we just pray tonight for those that are in need, those that are dealing with things. Some have been dealing with things for a long time. We pray for Jade tonight, still not feeling well. Lord, we ask that you would heal her. Her mom says that ever since she got COVID, she gets sick at least every other month. Lord, that's not right. That's not of you. So we rebuke that right now in your name, Jesus, and by the power of the Holy Spirit. We rebuke all lasting, remnant effects from COVID in Jade right now. Jesus, when you heal, you do a thorough healing. You make it as if it was never the case. We pray for George and Mildred that you would heal them completely from the top of their heads to the soles of their feet. Touch them, Jesus. One word and they're healed. We've seen it. You said, pick up your mat and walk. Men who were lame their entire lives were able to run and jump as if they had been running and jumping their whole lives. It wasn't just that you put the bones back in place. You gave them muscles. When you heal completely. Heal them, Lord Jesus. And for Ara, we pray that you would heal her from cancer. And her daughters also need healing from cancer as well. Lord, we ask that you would do a mighty work in their body. We ask that you would completely remove every cancer cell. Go and do what we can't. Go into every cell of their body and correct it. Make it whole. Jesus, do it because you're good. Do it to bring glory and honor to your name. That all would know that you are alive and that you are seated at the right hand of the Father. We give you all of the praise for those healings that you have done thus far. Thank you for healing our brother Austin. Thank you for healing Stormy. Lord, you are so good. Who are we that you are mindful of us? And you care about these things. You care about little things in our lives. You care about big things, our sicknesses, our families, protection. So, Lord, I ask that you would also turn your eyes to what's going on over there in the Middle East. Lord, I ask that you would bring this war to an end, to a close, that you would save all of those that are in this terrible, terrible situation. Protect the innocent. And bring everyone that is errant to the correct path, to the correct place. Because Jesus, when you show up, another thing you do is you make crooked straight. So Father, we ask that you would just do a mighty work there. Again, that all would know, because Lord, all eyes are on the Middle East right now. Let them know that you are God, Yahweh. Let them know. Thank you, Jesus, for who you are, for what you've done in us, and what you've placed in us, and who you're making us into. We are a new creation. Nothing in this entire universe has ever existed like what you've done. We worship you for that. We thank you for that. We give you this evening, this night. I pray now over everybody under the sound of my voice. Lord, I ask that you would bless them, that you would pour out your Spirit upon them, that you would give them all the things that they are in need of, and that you would, most importantly, reveal more of yourself to them, that they would see you even clearer than they do today, that tomorrow would be a clear picture, tomorrow would be more intimacy than they have today, and that it would continue and grow and grow and grow until they see you again face to face. We love you, Jesus, and we thank you. We praise your name, and all God's people said, amen. Amen, amen, amen. Let's give the Lord some praise, everybody. This has been such a sweet and wonderful time so far. The praise and worship was excellent. Thank you so very much, praise team, Ms. Stephanie, and your team. Thank you all so much. Let's thank them. We're going to continue with our service, but we're going to release our children to Children's Church. Youth, we're going to go out during the offering time, okay? So children, you can go ahead and stand on up and head back with Pastor Jadida to Children's Church. Enjoy yourselves tonight. Is there anybody here for the very first time? If you wouldn't mind just waving at me, we want to honor you as our first-time guest this evening. We've got a gift for you. Anybody here? You can just wave at me. Let me know this is your first time tonight. I'm looking around. I saw a couple of people wave at each other. That was kind of caught me there for a second. If you saw me look quick, that's what it was. Well, we'd also like to welcome those of you that are worshiping with us online. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. For all of our brothers and sisters around the world, we love you so very much. We think about you all the time. We pray for you all the time. We're so thankful of the relationship that the Lord has just developed and refined and brought forth. So we just thank you for joining us this evening. Let's go ahead and take a second and say hi to one another. If you would, please go ahead and stand up, move around the room, hug somebody, tell somebody they look good in the house of the Lord. Our way back to our seats, please. That would be great. All right. Okay, and for those of you that are just now tuning in online, the service is not over. It is now time for our announcements. So if you would, please turn your attention to the screens. Thank you.
Hello, Fellowship family. It's so wonderful for us to worship our Lord together. I'm Jennifer, and here are some announcements. Join us at Kingsville Christian Fellowship on Thursday at 7 p.m. for midweek worship service. If you're not able to join in person at KCF, join us through the live stream on KCF's Facebook page. Come and be a part of the great things that are happening at Kingsville Christian Fellowship. In observance of the Veterans Day holiday, the church office will be closed Friday, November the 10th. Should you need prayer, please call the church office and leave a message and someone will get back with you. We are excited that there will be a men's meeting this Saturday, November the 11th. Brothers, please sign up in either foyer and let us know that you will be there. Breakfast will be at 8:30 and the meeting will begin at 9. come early, bring your sons, and invite your friends. You don't want to miss it. And as a result of this meeting, the Kingsville Saturday morning Bible study will be postponed. We invite our brothers from KCF to join us here. If you are in need of being water baptized, please sign up in either foyer. Water baptism will be offered Sunday, November 19th, during the second service. This is a wonderful opportunity to publicly acknowledge your profession of faith in Jesus Christ. The Corpus Christi Christian Fellowship Care Poor Ministry Christmas Gift Drive will be held again this year. Last year, we collected 100 gifts for foster children in Nueces and surrounding counties. You can bring joy to a child's life by donating one or more toys for them to enjoy this Christmas. You can donate a gift to a foster or orphan child. Please go to the Care Poor Ministry table in the main foyer and see Sister Susie Baltazar after each service for more information. Now, listen to another important message. Sure to mark your calendars and save these important dates. We'll now return to our wonderful worship service. May the Lord bless you and keep you. Hello, Fellowship family.
You to mark your calendars. We're excited about the symposium, and we were really excited to get you the dates. And one thing we want to do, we mentioned it to some that heard on Sunday, we want some of our international partners to be able to come, and you can help us do that. And if it's in your heart, you can help us purchase airfare. These are pastors and leaders that have very effective ministries, and for them to get to come here and see us in the house, in Pastor's home church, and see the ministry that takes place, it would really enlarge them and be fruitful for them. So we want them to come, and you can help us do that. Another way besides helping with airfare, doing your little part or a big part on that, could be to offer a bedroom if you have a room in your home not being used, and you could help us there and have one or two guests. So pray about it. See what God would have you do. If you have questions, see me or pastor, and we'll bring them here. Thank you very much.
All right. Well, now it's time to give. It's now our offering time. Amen. If you need an offering envelope, you can raise your hand. Our ushers will be quick to give you one. That's how you get record of your gift. You can also give online or give by text. And we have the Get Out of Debt Covenant boxes on either side of the stage as well. The Lord gave this house a word that if we will get his house out of debt, he will get us out of debt. And let's prove him correct by getting this house out of debt. Amen. I'll go ahead and pray over the offering, and then you'll be in the hands of the ushers and youth. After I get done praying, you can go ahead and head back with me, and we'll have our service tonight. Father, I just thank you so much for this night. I thank you for all that you're doing here in Corpus Christi, here at Corpus Christi Christian Fellowship, and all that you're doing around the world. Thank you that in the midst of chaos, in the midst of storms, we can be at peace and be at rest because we're really seated with you. So I thank you, Jesus, for what you've given us and who you're making us into. And Lord, I ask that you would bless the offering tonight. Lord, I ask that it would go out and accomplish your will here on this earth. We give back to you out of love and worship, not out of obligation, but out of thankfulness, with grateful hearts, grateful that we have something to give, grateful that we're able to bless you and be a part of your work. It's no longer something in the past, no longer something just in Bible times. We're a part of this. Thank you. Thank you for choosing us and bringing us into the fold. You're so good. Bless the rest of this service. open up our hearts to receive what it is that you have for us tonight. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. The next voice you hear will be Pastor Tim Mutchler.
Just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind, 'cause I know there's peace within your presence.
Just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus.
Thank you so much, Sister Stephanie and team. Thank you very much. We appreciate you, and we appreciate all of you who are here. And we're here to worship, to give praise and honor to the Lord. And sometimes we may think that our place is insignificant, but I want you to know there is no insignificant member in the body of Christ. There is none. Each of us has a place. Thank you very, very much, very, very, very much for your presence. And I encourage you to continue, as the scripture says, and even more so as you see that day approaching. And so what I would like to say, those who are not making sure that they assemble together are not seeing. So those of us who are seeing that day approaching, he says to us that we should not forsake the assembling of ourselves together, as is the manner of some. Wow. So thank you so much for your presence. Amen. I wanted to come. I know Pastor Jackson said that Pastor Tim was going to come, would be the next voice. Of course, I said something to him about that and said, no, not quite. So I want to just say a couple of words about Pastor Tim as he comes. Sometimes my wife will talk to me about my introductions, and she will sort of help me make good introductions. I generally say, this is a good person. You know him. Let him come. You know, something really so profound as that. But really, with Pastor Tim, I wanted to say a few words. He's just, this is your brother. But sometimes when a brother or sister is among us, we take them for granted. And we don't know what they have brought until they're not here, or God reassigns them or something. And I wanted to just say how much I appreciate him with his heart, his mind, and willingness to do whatever is asked of him, and is willing to work hard. I've said to him once I've told you this maybe on a couple of occasions. One time there was something he was explaining to me, and I said, you don't have to explain anything to me. I know your heart. I know your heart, and I've seen your heart. And I also said, and I've never read about it, a 22-year-old young man going out and fasting for 40 days and night and not eating one morsel of rice or bread. I've never heard about it. I've never read about it. I'm not sure it even exists. And I said, you'd never have to explain your heart to me. I've seen it. And I want to just, So, and not only that, but he is a gospel preacher. And so I want Pastor Tim, I just wanted to say a few words about you. And then I want you to come up and preach the gospel tonight to your brothers and your sisters. Thank you.
All right, it's so good to see everybody tonight. How are you doing? Great, excellent. Thank you, Jesus. Pastor, thank you so much. The younger generation is able to do things because we've seen you go before and do all the things that you've done. And so we're so appreciative of you, sir. Very, very appreciative of you and Sister Marva. Yes, sir. Well, the message tonight is Abide in Christ, and I sort of tussled with it a little bit as I was thinking on it, and I was thinking, is this you, Lord, or is it me? Because I've shared on this recently a few times, but I started down that road, and as you just obey the Lord, confirmations come, and I just had a thought, oh, the article reading on Sunday, the vine. It's the appropriate time for this word. It's always the appropriate time for a subject like this, but you know what I mean. Well, let's turn to John chapter 15, verses 1 through 5. We are going to read there, and we're going to see what the Lord has done for us, who we are in him, who he is in us, and what he's afforded us. His shed blood, His forgiveness, His grace, His mercy, and His indwelling Spirit have afforded us much, much more than I believe we are often aware, and I believe much more than any of us are aware, no matter how far we've gone with the Lord, no matter how much we've given, there's even more to experience and encounter in God. In God, He's amazing. Let's read John 15, verses 1 through 5. Jesus says to His disciples, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, He takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, He prunes, that it may bear more fruit. You are already clean," or pruned back, "because of the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing." At first glance, these words may seem like a lot to a believer, but as you continue walking with the Lord, they become more and more dear to you. More and more dear to you, and it's like you can never suck the life out of them. Right? You can never soak up all of the nutrients provided by Christ in these scriptures. And so what I want to say to us as we start to look at these scriptures is that this conversation that Jesus is having with His disciples is at a very important time for Jesus. He's been waiting for this day. He's been wanting to have this conversation with His disciples for some time. It's been something that He's pondered in His heart. And He's just about to be given over to the cross. He's just about to go to crucifixion. And He's sharing an intimate moment with His disciples, perhaps up to this point, the most intimate moment with them. So they're behind closed doors, and He's looking at His 12 most eminent disciples, in a sense, in the eyes, having a sit-down conversation with them, talking to them about these words, this message that He gives. And He says to them, "I am the true vine. I am the true vine." The Wiest version, which is a different translation, says, "I, in contradistinction to anyone else, am the vine." So He's drawing a contrast, as Pastor has shared with us many times, between Himself as the true vine and every other source of life. Because really what we need to know is that there is an old life that wants to hold on. And we sometimes want to hold on to it. But Jesus says, "I am the true vine. I'm the true, the only true source of life. And if you will soak up the nutrients I provide, you will do well and you will be fruitful. I, in contradistinction to anyone else or anything else, am the vine, the genuine vine." And He goes on to say, "And my Father is the vine dresser." Now, I think we sometimes have too narrow of a view of what this word vine dresser means here. Whenever Jesus is talking about His Father as being the vine dresser, by definition, the vine dresser is one who tends to the vine. But what I want us to see tonight is that when we're speaking of God tending to the vine, it's not just in the sense of the gardener who comes up beside and takes a look at the vine and prunes and shapes it a little bit and works with it and pours some nutrients in. No, when we're talking about God tending to the vine, we're talking about Him being the entire environment in which the vine finds its life. He tends to the vine holistically, completely. The environment of Christ, right, is His Father, God. The environment as well of the branch connected to the vine is the Father. And that is very, very big for us to see. So as we get into this, right, as we get into this, let's keep those things in mind. He says, "Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, He takes away." And I can just I can just sense the disciples going, am I bearing fruit? Am I bearing fruit? I don't want to be taken away, right? Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. And then he comes back, and I think these words may also be of comfort to the disciples. He says, you are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. That word clean means pruned back. You've already been pruned back. So what we should notice here in these scriptures, as Jesus says, you are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you, is firstly that they comfort the disciples. And we should know, whenever Jesus is talking in this passage of scriptures, he's not talking in reference to speaking of salvation, right? Because we know that we are in Christ. If we believe in Christ, we are in him and he is in us. But here, he's speaking to the disciples about abiding in him, walking with him daily, communing with him daily, moment by moment, daily communion with God. And he does say here later on, someone might disagree and say, I think there's more to it than that, because he says in verse 6 that any branch that does not abide in him, he casts out. But what he's saying there is, you will either abide in me or you are on your way to abiding in me if you are mine. Right? He's not saying you can be a branch one day and be, cast out another day if you're a believer in him. That's not what he's saying. But he is talking to his disciples about the importance of hearkening to him, leaning into him, continually depending on him, which is something that seems foreign to many believers, right? Most of us often, right? It seems a bit foreign. We seem like we're grasping for the wind as we're trying to follow the Lord. But we should take Jesus at his word and dive deep into what he says here. Dive deep into what he says here. Because we can abide in him and he in us, and we can be very fruitful in our abiding. If we will take him at his word, hearken to his word, listen to his word, hold near and dear to his word, treasure his word. Pastor has said before to us that we can't keep what we don't treasure, right? We can't hold fast to what we don't treasure. So if we treasure Christ, we'll hold fast to him. We will depend on him. We will lean on him. In a fresh new way, I'm asking believers to depend on Jesus Christ, and Pastor has been as well. In a fresh new way. And it will cost you something, but the cost will seem like nothing as you believe Christ to do what he said he will do. Yeah, the cost will seem like nothing as we believe on him. Let's talk real quick about belief, about faith. In John chapter 6, if you don't mind turning there with me, John chapter 6. Jesus talks to us about faith and about abiding in him, in a sense. At least I believe these words are helpful to us when we talk about abiding in Christ and what that looks like. Oftentimes, whenever the scripture mentions faith, we don't quite get the import of it. In the New King James, in a lot of the English translations, the Greek isn't translated quite as intended. It's a good translation if you know the definitions, but you need to know the definitions. And so, in John chapter 6, he says to some who are asking him, how do we work the works of God? He replies back and he says, this is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he sent. That you believe in him whom he sent. And so we may, as believers, say, I believe in you, Lord. Why am I not fruitful? But we should catch what Jesus is saying here. In the Greek, what he is saying is, if you will continually be believing in me, right? Continually be believing in me, in the one whom God sent, that's the work of God, is to continually be believing in him. Continually looking to him, continually leaning on him. So I think that is big for us, right? When we talk about abiding, someone may be asking the question, how do I abide in Christ? I'm trying, you know, I'm trying to do all these external things. I'm trying to be righteous. I'm trying to walk uprightly. I'm trying to do this and that for God. I'm serving left and right, but still I find myself stumbling left and right. Jesus says, no, 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 son, daughter. It's not by work. It's by faith. It's by faith we serve. It's by faith we yield ourselves over to the ministry. It's by faith we love our neighbor. It's by faith we love our enemy. And so when the old nature tries to spring up, we just look to Jesus Christ in faith and say, no. My pastor's talked before about how we as believers are the only people on the earth that can say no. We can just say no to a thing, right? Yeah, yeah. We're the only people in the earth who can just say no. So we can say no to the flesh and instead turn to Jesus Christ. Now, I think, as well as believers, that we often don't realize that there is a lack. When God commands something, we say, I've been trying for years, Lord, and I still haven't gotten it. But we should recognize, if God has commanded it, it is possible, and we're to believe on him, and through faith, we will walk in it. But I've tried and failed so many times. Continue believing. Continue seeking. That throw in the towel mindset shows that we really don't believe. So we should hold fast to his every word. Hold close to his every word and believe it. When Jesus says, the scriptures say, the joy of the Lord is our strength. Right? Let's believe it. In the given moment, when we don't want to be joyful and we want to hold on to something else, right? The scripture says that many have become defiled by bitterness, right? Right? Many have become defiled by bitterness. It's paraphrased, but through bitterness, right? Many have become defiled. We hold on to some things. No, let it go to God. Let it go to God by turning to God and instead receive the joy of the Lord. The joy of the Lord doesn't always look like happy-go-lucky. No, it might be just having a serious face in a serious moment, knowing everything's going to be all right because of Jesus Christ. It might mean taking a few licks verbally from someone or physically from someone and holding our peace because we know it's going to be all right in Christ because we are his. I really think that we have not given ourselves over to faith like we might think we do. I've thought so many times in my life, I'm giving you everything I got. But no, Tim was giving everything externally to God that he thought he could give, right? I was trying to yield my own strength over to do God's thing. It doesn't work that way. Instead, Tim needed a heart, a mind set on the Lord Jesus Christ, fixed on who he is and what he's done. And there is enablement in that. There's enablement in that. Let's keep reading. He says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. I'm sorry. And my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes that it may bear more fruit. So we should know that God is going to continually be pruning us. And we should yield ourselves over to it. He says to us that his word prunes us back. There's a lot of trials that we go through in life. Some of them are unnecessary. We got ourselves into the situation. How? By not listening. If my kids listened to me, they wouldn't need the paddle. Not Annabelle, but those three boys. No, Annabelle will probably a little bit at some point. Right. But I'll be gentle. But if our children would just listen to us, right, the discipline wouldn't be necessary. His words will prune us back. If we listen, if we yield, if we believe, right, if we believe, and you may be saying, I believe, but maybe we should be saying what the disciple said when he came to Jesus and he said, I believe, Lord, help my unbelief. Help my unbelief. God has given us ample faith to believe. He's given us ample faith to believe. ample. That the word faith, belief, same thing. Trust, faith, belief, same thing. He's given us ample faith to believe him. We should just yield ourselves over to him, knowing as he is our source of life, that we can walk in what he's called us to and what he's given us to do. We can be kind when they are rude. We can love when we are hated. We can speak kindly when we are inappropriately rebuked, right? Or corrected by the world, tweaked by the world, right? Yeah, we can still be kind. It's possible. How? Through our own strength? No, but through Christ and a heart that's near him, a heart that's near him. I find that there is a need to be intimate with Jesus Christ. And that's my heart cry, is that we as believers would be intimate with Jesus Christ. Nothing else comes first. In fact, nothing else is even on the list. It's Jesus Christ. And that might be offensive to some because they say, well, what about the wife? What about the husband? What about the kids? What? No, if you put Jesus first, he'll teach you how to treat your wife when she's not acting the way that you want. She may not be acting the way you want because what you want is wrong. Yeah, it's not right. Maybe our perspective just needs to be changed, or vice versa. Or vice versa. He says, abide in me and I in you. Abide in me and I in you. And what I'd like us to see here as he says, abide in me and I in you, is that he's showing that there's a correlation between our abiding in him and his abiding in a manifest way in us. Yeah, you can walk in the manifest presence of God. It's possible. What you experience at the start, you can continue in, right? You remember when you first believed the Lord Jesus Christ and his spirit was just evident there in your life, moving. You knew God's nearness. You can walk in that. That's ours. That is the allotment God provided for the believer. But oftentimes we don't believe him for it and we don't walk in it. Because subtly, in the backgrounds, not of our heart but of our mind, we think, surely that's not possible. That I would be able to walk in the presence of God. That I would be able to encounter God in the midst of craziness. But the psalmist says, in the valley of the shadow of death, right? In the valley of the shadow of death, right? That he prepares a table before us in the presence of our enemies. So then God's presence is available to us. And we should believe him for it. That's what Christ is talking about here. That's what Paul is talking about. Every single time he talks about, in Romans 8, everywhere, about the Spirit of the Lord, the indwelling Spirit, the abiding Spirit. He's talking about God's presence. The Spirit of God, the presence of God, same thing. The Spirit of God brings us the presence of God, the very person of Jesus Christ. Paul says, now the Lord is the Spirit. Now the Lord is the Spirit. And if we'll just turn to him, we will experience his liberty. And we can turn to him at any point. And we can stay tuned in. We can stay tuned in. But if we find ourselves wandering, our mind wandering, we can just turn back to Jesus Christ. Yeah, someone once said, and I hope this is taken the right way, but somebody once said, this was a while back, a brother said, when I am in my prayer closet, I am so smart. But when I walk out, I am so dumb. And I thought, that is so right. But I'm finding that the prayer closet, we don't ever have to walk out of it. We don't ever have to walk out of the prayer closet. We may have to leave the house behind, right? We may have to go out into the public sphere, but we don't have to leave prayerfulness. And so we can remain smart. We don't have to be dumb. We can remain smart by remaining in Christ. That word abide, right? When Jesus says abide in me, he's saying remain in me. Be suspended in me. Stay in me. And that, again, that's not like we can be in Christ one moment and out of Christ another. No, he's talking about his manifest presence and our minds being set, stayed on him. Because Pastor has shared with us thoroughly that we have a heart that's been gifted to us by God. And in that heart, there's a perfect place. That heart is a perfect place where God inhabits us. And now our minds just need to be renewed. And the way that we renew our minds is not by trying to stuff. Now, there's nothing wrong with this, but just catch the nuance there. By trying to stuff scriptures in there. There's a lot of bad up here, God, so I need to get a lot of good in there. No, it's by looking to the Lord Jesus Christ and being filled with the nutrients of Jesus Christ as we read, as we pray, as we worship. There's a difference between trying and believing. And we need to come to the place where we are believing. Believing, not trying. Right? You know, whenever somebody says, I'm going to try to make it. No, you're not. No, you're not going to try to make it. Yeah, you're not. But trying to be nice, I catch the attempts. Yeah. But no, you're not going to make it. Yeah, we can either try in the Lord or we can be there in the Lord. Yes. By believing. Not by pulling ourselves up by our own bootstraps and just trying to make it happen and go, go, go. No. By looking to the Lord Jesus Christ and his enablement. I find it so amazing that as our minds are stayed on him, the impossible is possible. And the fruit of the Spirit abounds in us. Abounds in us. Okay. This is a little bit mysterious, at least for me, a little bit abstract, but I'm just going to reference some scriptures. Maybe Pastor or Brother Alex, I know he spent some time here. Maybe Pastor Stan could talk about this at some point. But let me mention a set of scriptures in the Song of Solomon that I find amazing and be such a great picture. There's this point in the Song of Solomon where the bride is having a dream, or the soon-to-be bride is having a dream, and she can't find the one she loves. And now we know that in the Song of Solomon, we're talking about Jesus Christ is the king, the beloved, right? And the Shulamite woman represents the church of Jesus Christ, represents us, represents the believer, right? So this Shulamite woman is trying to find her love. And the whole song is about God's love relationship with us and our love relationship with him. Do you have a love relationship with God, or are you just doing things because you think it might merit you something? It does nothing for you. God doesn't have anything to merit to you because you have nothing to offer him. Working will never get you anything with God because it's not necessary and because we can't do it. But we can look to Jesus Christ and give him what he wants. We can believe in him and fall deeply in love with God where the things of this world do not matter. It doesn't matter how they treat you because God loves you. That's the story that we see over and over again in the scriptures. The mighty men of God, the men of faith, the women of faith in the scriptures, they're treated terribly by the world, but they don't care. In one sense, they don't care. Why? Because God has called me. God has brought me near. I don't need affirmation from someone else, and I don't want it because God's given me enough of it. He's given me enough of it. More than enough. He said amazing things. You know, when David fell in the Bathsheba instance, God came to him and he said, I gave you everything. And if you would have asked, I would have given you more. I would have given you more. He gave the kingdom. He gave the woman to him, right? He gave everything to him. Wealth, resources, wisdom, power. He gave everything to him. And he said, if you would have asked, you didn't have to go out there looking for something. If you would have just asked me, I would have given you much more. That's Jesus for us. I would have given you much more. You remember Hannah in the scriptures, she's wailing over not having children, and her husband comes to her. Pastor's talked to us about this before. And the husband says, haven't I been better to you than 10 sons? I think it was a truthful statement. Haven't I been better to you than 10 sons? Jesus will be better to us than anyone and anything this world can offer. And anyone near us can offer. If we would just lean on him, look to him, genuinely love him through his genuine love for us. Paul gives us a secret in the scriptures in Ephesians when he says his prayer to the church in Ephesus. He mentions his prayer to the church in Ephesus, and he says that you may know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. If you want to be full of God, know the love of Christ. It's amazing to me because Paul doesn't say, if you love Christ, you'll be filled with all the fullness of God. He says, know his love for you, and you will be filled with all the fullness of God. Now, God doesn't just give us everything we want, right? If you think, oh, God, you don't love me because you haven't given me everything I want. I know we were talking a second ago about God saying, I would give you much more. But that's with right desires, right? That's when we're God, we're looking to God. God won't just give us things that'll spoil us. No, he won't do that. But those who delight in the Lord, those who delight in the Lord, he'll give us the desires of our heart. And when you delight in the Lord, what's the desire of your heart? When God comes to you and says, I'll give you whatever you want, you just say, I want more of you. That's all I care, more of you. I know you'll take care of the rest. You'll take care of the rest of the stuff in my peripheral view. You'll take care of all of it as my eyes are locked on you. He'll do it. He will do it that you may know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, just a general understanding of the Christian religion. He says, then you'll be filled with the fullness of God. Let's finish up with these verses. We'll look at Galatians chapter 5. 22 through 23. Jesus is talking about abiding in him and he in us, that we would bear much fruit, right? Here's the fruit that Jesus speaks of. Paul says, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness. This is the antithesis of the carnal man. This is the total opposite of the carnal man who wants what he wants and tries to get what he get. And when I say carnal man, I mean carnal man and carnal woman. Yeah, carnal man and carnal woman. Yeah, you may not see it, but everybody else does, right? He says the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. I mentioned this before. I'll mention it again because I think that these scriptures are clear to us when we see them right. We think when we read over those verses, Paul just gave me a whole lot to do. All right, I need to remember to love. I need to remember to be joyful and peaceful, and then I'll be filled with the Spirit. That's the opposite of what he's saying. He's saying, abide in Christ, and you will love. Set your mind on the Lord Jesus Christ. Fix your mind on him. If it tries to stray, just fix it on him. And there will be love. There will be joy. There will be peace. The peace of God. That's the kingdom of God. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. I just realized I didn't mention the portion of the Song of Solomon that I was trying to get to. So if you want to talk about that, talk with me about it afterwards or some other day, okay? Love y'all so much. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for this night. We thank you for your ever-abiding Spirit. We thank you, Jesus, for who you are and what you've done. May our minds be fixed on you, not on ourselves. May we not lean on our own understanding, but on you, Jesus, on you. So many of us, myself included, do not realize that we often lean on, at least sometimes lean on our own understanding. May you rid us of it, and may we lean on you instead, Jesus. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen and amen.
To give your heart to God. the essence of who you are. You want to give to God. If there's anybody like that here, I want you to come down to the front. Just come down quickly to the front. And one of these elders will lead you to Jesus. Or if there's somebody here, you say, well, I've been moved by the word of God, and I want to come down and just, as it were, to rededicate myself to these biblical truths. I want to rededicate myself to these biblical truths. I find that when I was a young man, I always wanted to rededicate myself to the biblical truths, always, because I needed it. I mean, it's not a thing of pride where, okay, I'm all right, I don't want anybody to think I'm not all right. It doesn't matter what they think, it matters what God thinks. Yeah, I need a couple of more elders here to just help us here. Yeah. Just come down, and because we've heard the word of God powerfully given. Powerfully given. And yes, we have several. We have several on the left and on the right. We've got some on your left, Dre. You can come over here. Okay. Yes, we have others. Just come and tell God about it. Have one of them agree with you. Man, that's good. There are amazing things that happen in agreement. In agreement. They will bless your life. They are anointed of God. They are anointed of God. Yeah. Let's walk it out. Let's walk it out. Come now. Yes. In Jesus' name. Come on. All of our ministering elders, you come as well. The ministering elders, our governing elders were here, but come, all ministering elders. So exemplary, but God led me to always say, more of you, more of you. Because I need that. I need that. More of him. More of him. Amen. Amen. All right. Message tonight, Pastor Tim. It's a great message tonight. And I'm now beginning to understand what those old preachers would say when I was young. Those old preachers would say things like, preach, son. Preach to me. Bless my soul, son. They would do that in the old days. And I understand now what they meant, because we need the word of God too. And you and I, we've assembled here not only for what we can give out, but what we can receive. And it has been important for us to be here tonight. I am excited about it, happy about it, and I'm blessing Jesus. Now, I would like to say Pastor Bert and Sister Martha had a family engagement. That's why they're not here. They're always here. Now, they become like pillars here, fixtures here. But they had a family engagement, and of course, I encouraged them in that family engagement. Why don't we stand together, and we'll be dismissed standing together. I'm so grateful. Thank you, Sister Steph, for the praise and worship. And if you don't mind, after we do the blessing, you can do another stanza of that, which you just finished. All right? Yes, sir. Okay, we'll do it. Just a minute. She just gave her heart to Jesus. Yeah. Yeah. Yes, thank you so much for that. I saw Austin here. Austin, where are you at? Austin Eno Horse, not Austin Leavell, right? Austin just had a surgery, and he said that the doctors were able to get every bit of the cancer, every bit of it. Says that people ought to always pray and never lose heart. That's right. You know, can I tell you a quick story? Just a very quick story. Some of you, if y'all gonna laugh at me, I'm not gonna tell you my story. When I was a kid, there was a guy, I was playing baseball, and I was up to the bat, and I stood up there, as Dizzy Dean said, confidentially, not confidently. Let me get my story. But anyway, the pitcher threw, and guess who it was? It was Joe Boy. Joe Boy. This is my negative Joe Boy story. So Joe Boy threw, and it was a ball. And I stood there, and it was a ball. And I said, there's nowhere in the world he's going to strike me out. I'm going to get on base without swinging. And so I stood there, strike. I said, can't throw three. Strike. Then I started to sweat. Strike. And that was a big lesson in my life. And I went back to my seat and I thought, never again will I live life waiting on a ball, waiting on a ball, waiting on a pass, waiting on a bye. If I go down, I'm going down swinging. It was that day. So I want us to live our lives like that. I wanted to just say that. Let's go down. If we should go down, let's go down swinging. All right? Go down giving it all. So let's lift our hands to Jesus and bless each other by saying, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you. The Lord be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you. And the Lord give you his peace. In Jesus' name, I bless you. Sister Stephanie.
Worthy is your